there's some questions about the movie night that's coming this Friday night. We're going to be showing God's Not Dead. The flyer said 7, but we're hoping that everybody knows that it's actually at 8. All right, so please know that it is at 8 o'clock, and the reason for that is we're going to have the movie outside, and it'll be a little bit darker, and we'll actually see it. So it's going to start at 8 o'clock. Please bring any of your camping chairs or blankets, whatever you want to sit on. I'll have some extra if you don't have something. We'll find something for you. But just bring a snack, and I think we're going to actually try to get some popcorn and stuff like that. If there's anything else that you want, or that you have to have while you're watching the movies, you can. Whatever it may be, just bring that with you. And then we also have a kids' Christmas play practice. All right, so I know it's August. We know that it takes a long time, it's a lot of hard work for these kids workers to work with the kids and get things going. They're going to start doing practice on Wednesday nights, and that's from 6 to 7. So please bring your kids out, and if y'all want to be a part of that, it would be a great thing. I don't know if everybody here has seen the Christmas plays, but I have a soft spot in my heart for the kids when they get up here. It's fun to watch them and see what they can do. Also, what's happening in our youth zone here, so just to let y'all know that we're still doing resilient faith Sunday school lessons at 10 o'clock. So any of the youth here, if you have youth that aren't actively in church somewhere, just come about us at 10 o'clock. I'll do that for through to the end of August and start to do and then on Wednesday nights, we have a Scary, Gross, and Weird Stories of the Bible that we start back again on Wednesday night. Had a couple of weeks that we kind of fell off from that. We've had some kids leave for college and done some other things for those guys. We're getting back into our Wednesday night class. And if you look here at the bottom, we got some other stuff coming up throughout the September. We got the Baptist Children's Home Barbecue Dinner Tour September 4th. And then a new prayer class begins September 7th. We have Men and Women on Mission September 8th. Sunday School Recognition Day on September 14th, and the Youth Big Dog Mudsling September 20th. And also I want to say that we're getting ready also for the Boyle Hill donations. That's going to be starting. So if you look in the pews, we have the envelopes there. If you want to get to the Boyle Hill Children's Ministry, we're going to be starting. But other than that, I hope you all have a wonderful day. Anybody know what time it is? Thank you.
because your maiden name begins with Sam at the cross.
Thank you. this is the first time I've ever been able to come here and share the word with you, you know, through the scriptures. And, I'm just honored and tickled to be here. So if I mess up, just forget about it, okay? Because, you know, it's me. It's my Lord. Anything I say right is his, anything I say wrong is mine. Okay? Just make sure we know that. We're going to be looking at something in the Old Testament today, and everybody probably is familiar with it. It's the crossing of the Red Sea. We've probably seen those Hollywood movies. You know, Charlton Heston had the big movie, and then, you know, all the 1960s special effects, which look kind of clean nowadays compared to what they put in the movies now. But everybody surely remembers the crossing of the Red Sea and that image that comes into our minds. There's a whole lot of things that go along with this crossing of this Red Sea. And this is found in Exodus chapter 14. And we're going to look at verses 19 through 31 in chapter 14 of Exodus. And while you're turning there, you know, I'll just kind of give you a little bit of an introduction. You know, the crossing of the Red Sea has got to be one of the greatest miracles that is in the Bible. I mean, who can top this? You know, it's amazing. And it's a fantastic event that shows us what happens when we trust God and we step out in faith and we do what He tells us to do. Now, so let's just look at the passage and then we'll come to it and see what God has for us here this morning. Starting at verse 19. And the angel of God, who went before the camp of Israel, moved and went before them, and went behind them. And the pillar cloud went from before them and stood behind them. So it came between the camp of the Egyptians and the camp of Israel. Thus was a cloud and darkness to the one, and it gave light by night to the other, so that the one did not come near the other all that time. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord caused the sea to go back by a strong east wind all that night, and made the sea into dry land, and the waters were divided. So the children of Israel went into the midst of the sea on the dry ground, and the waters were a wall to them on their right hand and on their left. And the Egyptians pursued and went after them into the midst of the sea. All Pharaoh's horses, his chariots, and his horsemen. Now it came to pass, in the morning watch, that the Lord looked down upon the army of the Egyptians through the pillar of fire and cloud, and troubled the army of the Egyptians. And he took off their chariot wheels, so that they drove them with difficulty. And the Egyptians said, "Let us flee from the face of Israel, for the Lord fights for them against the Egyptians." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea, that the waters may come back upon the Egyptians, on their chariots, and on their horsemen." And Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and when the morning appeared, the sea returned to its full depth, while the Egyptians were fleeing into it. So the Lord overthrew the Egyptians in the midst of the sea. Then the waters returned and covered the chariots, the horsemen, and all the army of Pharaoh that came into the sea after them. Not so much as one of them remained. But the children of Israel had walked on dry land in the midst of the sea, and the waters were a wall to them on their right hand and on their left. So the Lord saved Israel that day out of the hand of the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the seashore. Thus Israel saw the great work which the Lord had done in Egypt. So the people prepared the Lord, believe the Lord and His servant Moses. The words of the Lord. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank You for Your Word. We thank You for the many ways that You bless us and that You give us all the things that You do. We thank You, Father, that You give us this revelation of Yourself in so many ways. And Father, may we study Your Word today and hear from You what You have for us to learn. Fill us with Your Holy Spirit and illumine these pages and these words to us, Lord, that they may enter our very beings and be with us the rest of our lives. And got these Egyptians, okay, chasing the Israelites. How did all this come to be? Okay, what is Israel doing in Egypt to start with? Well, if we want to understand all this, we kind of have to rewind and know what happened before, so that we understand why we're in this situation right now. We'll turn this thing back 430 years. We're going to take a very fast trip from Genesis 17 right up here to Exodus 14. This crossing the Red Sea ended up being the climax of Israel leaving Egypt. Well, 430 years before all this happened, there was a young man named Joseph, and he was a son of Jacob, who was later renamed Israel by God. Okay? Now, Joseph was Jacob's favorite son. He was the youngest one. He had 10 older brothers. And those brothers were very jealous of him. Okay? So in an effort to get rid of him and out of their jealousy, they decided one day that they were going to sell Joseph. They'd get rid of him. Some of them wanted to kill him. The wiser one of his brothers said, no, we're not going to kill him. That's not the right thing to do. We can sell him off to somebody and tell everybody what to do. So that's what they did. They sold him off. He got carried off to Egypt. And he spent the first part of his life there in Egypt when he started at age 17. When you're 17 or right around that age, can you imagine being strapped to a donkey or a horse and drug off to some foreign country out in Egypt, out in the desert, and being made a slave? This is how Joseph spent the early part of his life over there in Egypt. Now, God had plans for this, okay? He wasn't punishing Joseph, but Joseph was a good kid. But Joseph was sent to Egypt for a reason. Now, God deemed at one point that the time was appropriate to reveal what he was about to do. So he told Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, in a dream, what he was going to do. It was kind of cryptic, and Pharaoh couldn't understand it. Okay? So it wound up that Joseph was enabled by God to interpret dreams. So he interpreted Pharaoh's dream for him. Okay? And he told him, hey, we're going to have 7 years of good, real good harvest, you know. I mean, the crops are going to really come in. And then after that, it's going to be 7 years when everything dries up. So what we got to do is we got to save up enough food to get us through the 7 years that's coming. Pharaoh thought this was amazing. So he made Joseph the second in command right below himself over Egypt. Now Joseph executed his plan to perfection. Okay, he saved all this food and got all this stuff back to ready for the famine. And when he did, they were ready. Nobody in Egypt had to suffer. Alright? So, but this famine wasn't limited to just to Egypt. Okay, it spread out. And when this famine finally reached out where Joseph's original family was, Jacob and all the sons out there, they were sent to Egypt to get food. Now, long story short, he could have pounded them and said, no, you know, you did this to me, you sent me here, you were so mean to me. But he didn't. He forgave them. He brought the whole family down to Egypt. They gave them the best part of the land down there. And for years and years, everybody remembered Joseph, okay? And the Israelites were allowed to live there, and they prospered, and multiplied and grew and just became a very strong, powerful people down there in Egypt. And I think that was just a good part of working with a group of people. But then as years went on, you know, I'm talking years and years, we're talking 400 years, you know, people got to forget about Joseph. And over these years, as years went on, the Israelites started getting treated cruelly by these Egyptians. Okay? So it came on the shoulders of another guy who was born Hebrew, and became an Egyptian, named Moses, to do something about this. Okay, now Moses, you know, if you remember Moses, you know, he was born to the Hebrews during the time when Pharaoh had an edict out that the midwives were supposed to kill all of them. Moses had a real strong, real, faithful, great mother. And she said, this boy is beautiful. There's no way that I'm going to allow him to die. So she hid him away for 3 months. And then she said, I've got to do something because he's going to get too big and we'll find him. So she put him in a basket and floated him down the river where Pharaoh's daughter found him. went over there and he defended that Israelite that he could get that thing, popped that Egyptian, and he got him so good that he killed him. He said, well, this changes everything. So he had to run off to a land called Medina, which is now Saudi Arabia. And he said, if I stay here, I'm going to get killed. So he ran off and became a shepherd. And he was tending sheep. He went from being an Egyptian to a guy's child. So he did that for 40 years. Age 40, he runs off. He goes from the shepherd for 40 years. Okay, so we're doing simple math here, 40, 40 days. Moses is 80 years old now, okay? He's not looking for a career change. He walks upon this bush. That's fine. And the Lord speaks to him through this bush and says, you're going back to Egypt because you got to get my people out of there. It's time for me to go. Well, he tried to protest and say, first we'll do that, then we'll need to do that. It's not for me. Find somebody else. But God was too strong for him. So he sends Moses. So Moses says, all right, I'll go. So he goes back to Egypt. He gets a meeting with Pharaoh. All right, so here's this old shepherd. This 80-year-old shepherd. You know, you imagine what he smells like. He walks in here and he gets this meeting with Pharaoh. All right, can you imagine this? This is this old shepherd. He says, you got to let these Israelites go. That's Pharaoh's like, who are you? What are you talking about? Let this crazy guy in. No, God said you got to let the people go. He said, well, I'm not going to do it. So, as the story goes on, God starts progressively sending these plagues on Egypt to prove to Pharaoh that, hey, I've sent this man to give you my word. Well, and there was all these plagues, okay, turned the river into blood. First, it might have been Pharaoh, this happened, that man, he may not have just said, go. I don't want anything to do with this. But it took him 10. It took him 10 plagues. I mean, frogs, gnats, flies, darkness. I mean, all the livestock died. There were boils on people's skin. It was awful thing after awful thing. And Pharaoh still wouldn't. So finally, the Lord said, all right, I'm going to send angel of death through Egypt, and I'm going to kill the firstborn son of every household. But he gave Moses instructions on how Israel would be saved by killing a lamb each household and putting the blood on their doorframe, and that angel of death passed by. But when this happened, this totally broke Pharaoh, so he let him go. All right, so. This was the straw that broke Pharaoh's hard heart. So Moses leads this huge multitude of people out of Egypt. And the Bible tells us that it was 600,000 men, excluding women and children. Okay, so we know that this had to be well over a million people. And if you study this a little bit, it's probably right around in somewhere in the neighborhood of 2 million people walking out of this place. Now this is not, you know, going to Sam's Club and standing in line. This is 2 million people walking around. I mean, this is big. So, as they're traveling through the desert, God provides for them a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. I have no idea what this thing looked like, but we know that God provided this to them for their protection. Okay? They follow this cloud. Okay? And for some reason, this way that they followed, it wasn't just a straight shot. You know, it wasn't like, okay, we're going straight up from here to there. It was kind of a winding path that they took. And what happened was, you know, they're out there following this cloud around, and it's kind of winding them around and going some strange directions and stuff. Pharaoh kind of had his eye on them and said, you know what? These Israelites, they're out there just wandering around. They don't have a clue where they are. And this is letting them go. This is the wrong thing to do. So he got all his men, got his army, and chased them down out into the desert. Said, we're going to bring them back. They're not going to be out there wandering around. So at this point, this was about probably day 3 or 4 of this journey. scripture, it's Exodus 14. It says, and the angel of God went before the camp of Israel, moved and went behind. And the pillar of cloud went from before them and stood behind them. So it came between the camp of the Egyptians and the camp of Israel. Thus was the cloud and the darkness to the one, and it gave light by night to the other. So that the one did not come near the other all that time. Okay? Now, I don't know if you can imagine yourself picking up all your possessions, leaving the only home you've ever known, with 2 million of your closest friends, walking away, whatever you can hear. Okay? And you're following this prophet of God who says that God is going to come home for you. I mean, this is really, like, mindful. Now, you know, even though they had witnessed all these miraculous signs, these plagues and things that God had sent on them, killing them first, not killing them to have blood on their house, and all that stuff, they were still, you know, they were still a little shaken. And it had to be a little unnerving for them, to say the least. Now, this pillar of cloud, you know, that went before, obviously, you know, it had to provide some kind of protection for them during the day, probably kept the sun from harming them. And by night, it provided this light so that they could see and they didn't step in a hole or get bit by some kind of wild animal or something. So this thing was going before them. Okay? And we know that the angel of God was traveling before them too. They may not have been able to see him, but he was there because the scripture right here tells us that. And so, you know, they're getting near the Red Sea, this anxiety is kind of building, but they're not really feeling like they're in danger yet. They're just kind of like wrong, you know, man. We don't have our stuff. We don't have all the stuff we have. Well, as they're sitting there on this beach, they look up and they see these Egyptians. This is when terror strikes. So these Egyptians are approaching. And what happens? This pillar of cloud, this pillar, and this angel change roles. It changes positions and it changes roles. Okay? Before it had been guided and leading, and they were following. Well, now this thing moves around behind them. Okay? So what's happened? These things that God has provided for them now have a new purpose. Now they're back here standing between the Israelites and the Egyptians. And it's not so much to fight the Egyptians off, but it's I think it's more of a visual barrier. Okay? Because it's saying it's darkness on one side and it's light on the other. Okay? This is kind of protecting. You know, when a kid gets scared about something, you know, the best thing they can do is, you know, you
child out his eyes so he can't see that danger, see that scary thing.
You know, you see these guys on TV grab these alligators. You know, they cover their eyes up and calm them right down. God's calming these Israelites down by blocking their view, he's approaching Egyptians. Okay? And it's just some kind of comfort, you know, it's protection. There's some good verses that tell us about how God's protection comes to us. Psalm 5. 11 and 12. But let all those rejoice who put their trust in you. Let them ever shout for joy because you defend them. Let those also who love your name be joyful in you. For you, O Lord, bless the righteous. With favor you will surround him as with a shield. In Psalm 37, 28 and 29. For the Lord loves justice and does not forsake his saints. They are preserved forever, but the descendants of the wicked shall be cut off. The righteous shall inherit the land and dwell in it forever. This formula that we're seeing here is simple. Love for God plus faith in God equals protection of God. So when we love God, you know, he stands for us and he protects us. That's what he's doing right here. And when we use our faith, God's protection is activated in our lives. Nothing can stand against us, but God is right there protecting us. And the more we have faith, heart of you, to keep you in all your ways. In their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. You shall tread upon the lion and the cobra, the young lion and the serpent you shall trample underfoot. Because he has set his love upon me, therefore I will deliver you. I will set him on high, because he has known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With a long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. Now this verse 20 is also telling us that this cloud brought darkness to one side and light to the other. Now, you know, y'all know that I'm a musician, and when I read this, it kind of reminds me of being on a really well-lit stage in a dark theater or outside the band high. The lights are shining down on the stage, and you're almost surprised you don't even think the cloud is clean. But you can only see about maybe two rows out in front of you, and it's just total darkness. You know that there's people back there, but you just can't see them. And I think this is kind of like how the light would have been on the Israelite side of this cloud. That it's just this bright light, and they can't really see anything else. And on the other side, it's so dark that the Egyptians can't even see. They can't even see their hand in front of their face. They can't even move. They are just absolutely paralyzed by this darkness. Okay? So this is like a major divide between these two groups. This cloud that God has provided has become an impenetrable wall of darkness for one side and light for the other. 2 Samuel 22:29 says, "For you are my lamp, O Lord. The Lord shall enlighten my darkness." So God's turning this time of darkness for the Israelites into an incredible time of light. And he's displaying their awesome power. Moving on, verses 21 and 22. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord caused the sea to go back by a strong east wind all that night, and made the sea into dry land. Waters were divided. So the children of Israel went into the midst of the sea on the dry ground, and the waters were parted on their right hand. So just when it looked like the Israelites were trapped here between the sea and the Egyptians, God does something amazing. He opens this thing up and there's dry ground. I mean, who can say, anybody in this room can say, I've walked on dry ground in the middle of the sea? Nobody. Moses immediately raised his staff and did what God told him to do. Now we know it wasn't his staff or his hand or anything else that did this. This was God's way of instilling trust in Moses for the Israelites. You know, if Moses hadn't believed God and obeyed him and done what God told him to do, none of this would have ever happened. Now I'm going to get to the science nerd part of this message today, because you can't look at an event like this without looking at some real science, and some of the real evidence that's out there about this. Okay? We call it evidence, but it's things, you know, if you look into the archaeology, everything they find, scripture always is confirming the archaeology, not the archaeology confirming the scripture. There's a lot of research on this very topic that we're talking about today, this crossing. A lot of different theories out there. Now, I did my own research, and I'm just going to give you my own personal opinion on what I think about this. There's a beach in Egypt called Nubeba, N-U-W-E-I-B-A. Okay? And it's on what's called the Gulf of Aqaba, which is an arm of the Red Sea. Now, there's a lot of physical evidence that, for me, it says this has got to be the right place. Okay? For one, there's an underwater land bridge that goes down from one beach and up to another beach. Okay? This thing is a half mile wide and it's 11 miles long. Okay? And at the deepest point, out in the middle of it, at the deepest point, it's 1,000 feet below sea level. Alright? On either side of this land bridge, water 5,000 feet. So these people, these Israelites, you know, wouldn't have been like all treacherous and trying to climb down the sea and steep and hard to do. This, they would hardly have known they were going down, you know, and almost left. God has for years since He created this world, put these canyons right where He placed them and had them washing down. He was preparing this place for Israel across the sea at this particular time. They dove down into this water, they found chariot wheels. They found horse remains. And they found human bones. Okay, if you've never heard this story, if you've never read this story in the Bible, you'd have to say, man, something crazy happened here. There's a bunch of bones and chariot wheels and horses and stuff down under the water right here. What in the world happened? It's amazing. But we know that the scriptures are right. Now another interesting fact that strikes me interesting is that scientists have done the math and have determined that walking at normal pace, 2 million people on this half mile wide strip could walk 11 miles in about 8 hours. He's perfectly calculated this out so that his children will be able to do this every day. So all through this time, this pillar of fire and clouds provided light for them across the sea and then provided darkness over here to keep these Egyptians paralyzed. Verse 23 through 25. And the Egyptians pursued and went after them into the midst of the sea. All Pharaoh's horses, his chariots, and his horsemen. Now it came to pass in the morning watch that the Lord looked down upon the army of the Egyptians through the pillar of fire and cloud and troubled the army of the Egyptians. Got the chariot wheels so that they drove them with difficulty. And the Egyptians said, let us flee from the face of Israel, for the Lord fights for them against the Egyptians. So once the Israelites get over there on the other side, okay, God's starting to allow the Egyptians to move. Okay, it's saying, it's telling us that this is the morning watch, but this is called the fourth watch. They have four watches through the night. You know, when you're out in desert, you've got to keep people moving around. You know, you've got to have some security. Some people have got to stay awake and look around. But there was a watch from 6 p.m. to 9 p.m. There's a watch from 9 p.m. to midnight. There's a watch from midnight to 3 a.m. And then there's a watch from 3 a.m. to 6 a.m. Okay, so this is the fourth watch. This is the 3 to 6 a.m. watch. So we know the sun is starting to come up now. Okay, so we're starting to get a little daylight. So, the Egyptians are going to start using this little bit of daylight to start moving. So, okay, we can see now, let's go get these Israelites. But as they got themselves committed into crossing this sea, it's too late for them. They realize that this has been set as a trap for them, that God is truly fighting for the Israelites. And we all know what happened. Then the Lord said to Moses, stretch out your hand over the sea, that the waters may come back upon the Egyptians, on their chariots, and on their horsemen. And Moses stretched out his hand over the sea. And when the morning appeared, the sea returned to its full depth, while the Egyptians were fleeing into it. So the Lord overthrew the Egyptians in the midst of the sea. Then the waters returned and covered the chariots, the horsemen, and all the army of Pharaoh that came into the sea. Not so much one of them. So after they get on the other side, God again instructs Moses to stretch his hand back out over the sea. Okay? And it's going to close back up. So Moses obeyed him, and all Pharaoh's army got swallowed up by the sea coming back together. You know, this great army that threatened is now destroyed. 100%. He didn't leave one horse, he didn't leave one soul. Got them all. Can you imagine the sound of 2 million people going, whoosh? This has got to have been some mind thing to this. Isaiah 45:7, God says, I form the light and create darkness. I make peace and create calamity. I, the Lord, do all these things. seemingly all these things. Closing down the last three verses. But the children of Israel had walked on dry land in the midst of the sea, and the waters were walled on their right hand and on their left. So the Lord saved Israel that day out of the hand of the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the seashore. Thus Israel saw the great work which the Lord had done in Egypt. So the people feared the Lord and believed the Lord and served Moses. So as the Israelites have watched, you know, these waters crash and destroy these Egyptians, they got to realize that God has saved them from something from which they could have saved themselves. And when they see this, and they put their trust in God, they put their trust in Moses, they follow him. And we know that after that, they move on to Mount Sinai, and God gives Moses the Ten Commandments, and then Israel backslides, and all this kind of stuff happens. You know, his intention was to move them right on into the promised land. But they rebelled, so they had to wander around in the desert for 40 years. They eventually made it, we know, but you know, their resistance to God made it a lot more difficult. Now let's apply this whole passage. It's a wonderful story, but what does it mean for us when we walk out the door together? Okay? Each of these elements that we find in this story can be interpreted into our lives. Okay? First thing we see these Israelites, we run into them in here. They're slaves. They are slaves in Egypt. Okay? Now, if we think about that, here on this earth, in our natural state, when we're put here on this earth, we are slaves to the evil because of what our father had. Okay? That's what we're born into. We don't ever know any different. We're always a slave to sin. And you know, because we live in this world is all we've ever known. Okay? We came into this world, this is how we live. It's hard for us to look at it and say, we can't really live. It's hard for us to separate ourselves from the world. That's what we're called to do. It's always a challenge. No matter how long you live, how faithful you are, you go to church 3 times a week, whatever, it's always a challenge. Because this earthly part of us wants to hang on. You know, we're afraid to leave our own home. We want to try to bargain with God. But when we hear the gospel, we're called to not be in this world anymore. Okay? We're called to follow Him to a more wonderful life that we can ever imagine that's waiting for us. Okay? It's hard. We have a natural tendency to resist change. But we've got to have faith, take our faith, and the Holy Spirit comes and lives within us and gives us that strength. Now, following God, you know, we begin to follow this path that God has given us. Think about the path that the Israelites were on. They were out there winding around, and why are we going this way now, why are we going that way? It looked like they were confused. Well, you can't question that. You know, God's path may seem strange to us, but He tells us that His ways are not our ways. We'll not always understand why He has us to go certain directions that He has us to go. You know, the enemy and lost people are going to think you're weird. They're going to think you're confused. They're going to think, why in the world are they doing that? It doesn't make any sense. But it doesn't. It makes sense to God. We have to trust that He has the best thing for us. Now, once we make this decision, okay, and we say, we're going to follow God, does the evil one just look at us and say, well, okay, that's what you're going to do, that's fine. In fact, this one, we should look at it. Let him do that. Just like Pharaoh, man, he hitches up the horses. Each one comes down. He's chasing you down. He wants to chase you down and then won't let you get away. Just like Pharaoh, he's Israelites. Now, as you're following God, eventually, this ocean, it's like, look at all this sin. It's in my life. I've got, what am I going to do? Okay? I'm just like Israel. I don't have a boat. I don't have any way to get across this thing. What am I going to do? This thing is way more than 11 miles wide. Or it's going to turn me over. And I'm trapped. I've got the devil chasing me over here. I've got this, all this sin. Well, luckily, I don't have to do anything. Because Jesus comes between me and my enemy. Just like the cloud in the rain came between Israel and Egypt. Okay. He provides the light. He provides those waters for us. What Jesus did for us on the cross. And his cross becomes my cross. When we realize, we admit that it's only by His Word that we can be saved and carried across the sea. You know, we can step out in faith. We can have these walls on our right and on our left, and we can walk through that. And we can reach that other side, and we can reach that side that He's calling us into. I don't have to be afraid of evil. Psalm 27:1 says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Whom shall I be afraid?" Just as I could cross over the sea on my own, okay? When I get over here, those waters close back up, and I can't cross back. I'm in a new place. God has put me over here, and He's closed that water back up. You don't have to worry about that. Now, am I going to be tempted to stray and do things wrong? Sure, I'm still human. But I'm a new creation. I am a new creation. And I crossed over from slavery to the evil into the service of Almighty God. John 5:24, Jesus says, "Most assuredly I say to you, he who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has everlasting life, and shall not come into judgment, but is passed from death." I just want to tell you, if you're living as a slave to sin today, you know, you don't have to stay there. You don't have to stay there any longer. You may think you're too far gone. You may think you've got more sin than God can ever clean up. But you don't. He can divide this. He can take you out of that. He can take you through it. And protect you from his chasing. The price has already been paid. The penalty was nailed to the cross and left behind in the tomb. It's yours to claim. Let's cross over again. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we marvel at what you've done for us. Many ways that you bless us, many miracles, Lord, that you have revealed to us in your word here in our own lives. We're humbled by it. Father, we don't always Well, praise the Lord that he is. You know, when you're a kid, you learn a little prayer to pray before a meal. God is great, God is good. It almost sounds like a home back and stuff. Sometimes I think great is better than good. Thank God that God is great and powerful. That he's also good. It's my prayer today that each of us would go from here. The realization of how much God loves us and that we're trying to love. May that love, Father, grace, the Son, and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be each and every one of us today. Let's stand and close the service as Lewis would do it. With a great name.